Welcome to Therapy with Gone with the Wind, where we talk all about the things that happened last couple nights ago at the Golden Globes. So, cue the music. Hey everybody, welcome to the show about award shows. This is Gone with the Wind, and today I know you are feeling the aftershock of the Golden Globes 2019 as much as we are, because film Twitter was lit up, we shall say. Some movies have now revealed themselves as the winner. Some are currently giving us a little bit of, shall we say, a last-minute push before the Oscars comes out. Because today is, in fact, when we are recording this on a Tuesday, this is the day the Oscar ballots are due, I believe. Right, Ryan?
They are opening today. Which is a Monday, not a Tuesday.
So, wait, today Monday? See, I'm so used to us recording Tuesday that now I'm just kind of like my days are blurred together. Because, man, work's going to be great on a Wednesday.
It's Tuesday for me.
Oh, well, hey, I'm not wrong. I'm not right, but...
Well, there you go.
Hey, Ryan's here, guys.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
And also, we have a guy who's apparently in the future, Malcolm.
Hi, everyone.
And that leaves just one regular usual suspect, I should say, in Abe.
Hi, can we talk about the playoffs instead?
No, this is not... What did I... I'm not even going to try to use whatever terrible pun I use to talk about football. This is not a sports podcast, eh? You can go somewhere else for that. This is all about movies and Oscars and apparently now the Golden Globes. Are you that jaded because of what happened? Wow. It's no secret that that none of us, maybe except for Malcolm, are huge fans of Bohemian Rhapsody, the film. I wish we all had Malcolm's disposition on the film so we could love it as much as he does. But we are looking at a current lineup that is different than what we ever possibly imagined a couple weeks ago, maybe even a month ago. But before we get into the actual winners of the Golden Globes, let's start on a high note. What have we watched this week, and what have we enjoyed from the subsequent watches? Ryan, you have done a lot. You weren't here with us last week, but you have seen a lot of movies this past couple of weeks, including the Christmas holiday season. What are some of the highlights that you saw that really stuck out with you? Terrible or great?
Let's start with the good things, and then... Or let's start with the bad. Get the bad out of the way. I saw Vice. That movie is terrible. It can go to hell.
We should have placed bets on if he liked it. He didn't.
On the good side of things, I got to see If Beale Street Could Talk, which was excellent. I got to see The Favorite, which was real good. I got to see At Eternity's Gate, which I'm still thinking about. And then kind of a bunch of stuff in the middle. I got to see Beautiful Boy, Mirai, Mary Poppins Returns, and Aquaman. So that was my little string of movies recently.
What was the favorite film you saw out of all those? Your favorite film?
Definitely Beale Street Could Talk, for sure.
Nice. Because I agree. Out of the ones that I've seen this week, that was the literal highlight of my of what I saw. I also saw a movie, another indie film called Thunder Road. Have you heard of that one?
I haven't.
No, it's a small, I think it was one of the work by South by Southwest, I believe. It was on Amazon Prime. I gave it a watch, and it was actually really good. It was very heartwarming, very short, but the guy, Jim Cummings, starred, directed, and wrote the movie. So that is always an impressive feat when someone does that. Easily, the story and screenplay were fine. I wasn't blown away by any of that, but his performance and the directing, he definitely knows how to work a camera and knows exactly what looks good, because this movie was very well done for a budget that you could definitely tell was not astronomical. So it's a really nice, great character study on the character, the police officer he was playing, because he was basically, his life was falling apart, trying to retain custody of his daughter while trying to deal with the loss of his mother. So being also very socially awkward and having some anxiety, it was him basically struggling with all that. And I think it was very well done. But also, there's another movie I saw, If Beale Street Could Talk, and you guys know how excited I am about that film. Actually, first off, I think Ryan liked it more than I did. If we looked at our list,
I guess. It depends on what
I haven't seen your back, but
oh well. I did love it. I was reading an article in the American Cinematographer where Barry Jenkins and the what's the guy's name? I can't remember the cinematographer's name. It's gonna kill me because the cinematography in this is utterly gorgeous and might be my favorite of the year, because there is something they use in the colors and the how they used just the craftsmanship of the film. You look at the cinematography, how it melds with the costuming, how it melds with the production design. Some of the characters are perfect. Like what they're wearing perfectly is a great contrast or a complementation to what the production is. There was such care taken in the camera movement and how it's very fluid and sometimes handheld most of the time when it's in the past and much more stagnant and in the person's face in the present. The story I felt sometimes, but I love when it went to the romantic side of the story, because even though I was not in the mood for a romance at all, something as intimate as that was, I was just kind of like, probably like, oh, I don't care about that. Meh. Oh, that's just, you know, you're in a mood for that sometimes, and sometimes you're not. That day I was not. And I'm hopefully going to see it again soon with a fresh perspective in mind, and hopefully fall in love with that. And of course, the side story about the injustice in the criminal system, I thought was good. I wish they explored that a bit more so I could have, you know, cared, because I really cared about their love story. But some of the side stories, I wanted to fall in love with a bit more, but I did not. Also, Brian Tyree Henry? I believe is his name. Can anyone confirm this? He is the plays
the cinematographer. James.
You can. Laxton. James Laxton. That's it. So good.
Oh yeah.
Such a good cinematographer.
Yeah. No, you're right, Manning. Brian Tyree Henry.
Okay. To talk about a true supporting performance, he was on for 10 minutes, and I was just kind of like, the story he told, I was utterly enthralled. He's had a great year. Great year. For Widows, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. I think he's in a couple more films. I think White Boy Rick, I believe, is also in.
He was in that movie.
Yeah, so he's had a great, Into the Stratosphere. So Beale Street is a great film. Definitely to see it again under the right circumstances. But just from a craftsmanship perspective, Barry Jenkins is utter perfection. Utter perfection. Again, he and I'm just kind of waiting for him and Damien Chazelle to do a movie every year together, and just kind of just to do it, because I'm not looking forward to these two guys every year whenever they make a movie, because they are some of the people looking up.
Yeah, that would actually make an interesting double feature if Beale Street Could Talk and The First Man.
It would actually.
It would be very, very slow, though. You'd have to really be awake.
I think this one's almost slower than Moonlight. Almost slower than Moonlight.
Oh, it's 100% slower than Moonlight. This movie is and I don't mean that necessarily about
negative way. No.
But it's like pulling really sticky toffee apart. It's just like pulling these moments just very, very slowly.
Yeah, they are. Yeah. It was definitely slow, but yeah, not in a negative way whatsoever, because it made you. This is probably one of the most intimate films I've ever seen. Like, I felt like I was literally with these characters the entire time, and sometimes to the point where I was like, should I be here? I just felt like this was this special moment between these characters, to where I felt for them more than kind of the other supporting cast, but they were the highlights for me personally. And you guys, Abe and Malcolm, you haven't seen Beale Street yet, right?
No.
I don't think it's even out in New Zealand yet.
I don't blame you, because it is literally just came out in my city last week.
Yeah,
I watched four films this week.
What did you see, Abe? Four. Move on from Beale Street.
I watched The Favorite.
Hey,
I really like.
It's
sticking with me. That's the thing. Like, I'm thinking about it like every day. I really like this. I don't know if can like I haven't done my top 10 secured, but Olivia Colman, it's amazing. I love her last night in the Golden Globes. We'll talk about that later. She's just amazing in the movie. She's charismatic as fuck.
Can I ask a question about Olivia Colman?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
She's great in that movie, and I'm happy that she's getting attention. But she's not the lead of that movie.
Oh, no.
Okay. It is an ensemble. To me, all three are the...
I think it is, but if I had to pick one lead,
it's Emma Stone.
You have to pick one. It's Emma Stone.
Yeah, definitely.
She's the quote-unquote favorite. Like, how it goes to me is it is Olivia Colman, or excuse me, it is Emma Stone, Olivia Colman, Rachel Weisz.
Yeah, Rachel Weisz is not...
She is the clear... She is supporting, if there's anyone who's supporting. Which I still think that it's an ensemble piece and all should be either lead or all should be supporting. They're not going to, because... Why would they do that?
I think that's a really weird choice. Like, you think that Emma Stone would compete better in lead than Olivia Colman would? Like, I'm a little perplexed.
I think if, like, Olivia Colman would have a better chance. I haven't watched Beale Street, like, with Regina King, but she would have a better chance winning supporting if they were pushing her in it.
I actually, I'm not sure how that would work, actually. Maybe because, also, yeah, speaking of Regina King.
Emma Stone to lead and Olivia to support.
True. Maybe because they thought that their supporting players might have a better chance in supporting. Mm-hmm. But speaking of supporting actress, you just mentioned Regina King. I was not really taken away with her in Beale Street.
She's got one absurdly powerful moment that just like ate my soul. So I understand where she's getting this.
Yeah, but I wasn't like, give her the Oscar. Oh, I'm going to pass out. It's so emotional. It was like, oh, man, this is really, like, I was not as enthralled as I was, like I said, Brian Tyree Henry, someone like that. It was the moment when she went to Puerto Rico, correct? Is that it?
Yes.
What? Okay.
Oh, what?
Careful.
Oh, okay.
Oh, thank you for the spoiler. Now he goes to Puerto Rico.
That's why I didn't say specifics about why she went. I mean, because it's in the trailer. I mean, one of the shots is in the trailer, so. But they don't say
where
she went.
Maybe Miami or something.
You're right. She remember when she went to Florida? Is that the one you're talking about, Ryan?
Totally.
Okay. Yes. No, I get it. But I was just like, she wouldn't. I, from all the hype that was built up, I was not properly met, we shall say, for the supporting performance. Although I had the same issues with Allison Janney last year for I, Tonya.
Oh, she was amazing.
Yeah, she was awesome.
I don't know. I liked Laurie Metcalf better. I was on the Laurie Metcalf train. That was me.
You were wrong. You were in the wrong.
Sure I was. I'm still the host of this call. I will kick you out, sir. Malcolm, did you see anything?
I haven't finished my four movies. Sorry, Malcolm.
No, you're done. Abe, you're done. I'm kidding. Abe, no. You can go.
Sorry, Malcolm. I didn't want to interrupt you. I just want to talk about these.
Go ahead.
I watched two pieces of shit. I watched Truth of Dare or Dare and Peppermint? I caught them. I just needed worst movies for my list.
It's impossible.
And I watched this amazing film, Blind Spotting, directed by this guy called Carlos Lopez Estrada, which is an amazing film. Everybody should watch it. I just watched it today. So I'm still like processing it. And just want to say that. Watch that movie. It's amazing.
Yeah.
Bye. On my list. Great. And now, Malcolm, what did you see?
I finally got around to seeing A Quiet Place the other day. Woo!
And
I loved it.
Okay. Good.
It was what I would consider sort of a modern take on the silent movie sort of genre. So, because I mean, there was some talking in it, but it was mostly silent. Like, and the music was more the one telling the story and building the suspense. I mean,
no, the sound and music, yeah.
Yeah. And Emily Blunt and John Krasinski were amazing in it. But yeah, I can totally understand why Emily Blunt's getting love for A Quiet Place as well.
Yeah, well.
Thank God. That performance is not going forgotten.
a SAG nomination is definitely making it not be forgotten. I can tell you that.
That made me so. I was not on your show when you guys talked about the SAG nominations, but that made me so unbelievably happy over break.
No, yeah, I imagine so, because she was fantastic. Honestly, at this point, I'm just hoping that she just gets her Oscar nom, because the fact she doesn't have one still is just baffling.
Mm-hmm.
Baffling. But speaking of Oscar nominations, Oscar nominations, guys, are in 2 weeks, and we have some precursors to get through. Speaking of last night, this is Monday. This is Monday for me and Ryan and Abe, but this is Tuesday for Malcolm. So clarification on there, guys. Sorry, Malcolm. We had the Golden Globes this past Sunday, and... Well, before we get into that, let's go into what we had prior. We had the PGA nominations announced. We had a lot of guilds actually start getting their nominations out here, ready for us to really dig into our teeth of what the race is shaping up to be. And for our PGA nominations, and of course, I lost everything because I had to kick them all off because...
I got them.
You got the PGA nominations?
I got the PGA nominations.
I got the PGA. Get ready for the... get the Ace Eddies. Up, okay. And actually,
I have everything.
So. You have everything up. Okay, then I will do PGA, and I'll let you get ready for the Ace Eddies. We're gonna have Ace Eddies. We have American Society of Cinematographers. We have the Art Directors Guild. We have WGA. Abe, can you look up the WGA for us?
Yes.
And Malcolm, can you look up the Society of Cinema, the American Society of Cinematographers?
Yeah.
If you can. All right. And we're going to go show each of them and kind of show what we believe is making its way downtown to the Oscars. So the Oscar frontrunners that we have so far, Star is Born, Roma, Black Panther, Green Book, Favorite, all those are your usual suspects, but we have some surprises, some pretty awesome surprises this year. We have currently Black Panther, Black Klansman, Bohemian Rhapsody, Crazy Rich Asians, The Favorite, Green Book, A Quiet Place, Roma, and A Star is Born, and of course, Vice. If you don't see everyone, Ryan just stuck his big old middle finger up at the camera. So someone does not like Vice at all. What do you think about Christian Bale before we continue on?
His performance.
He's fine. Okay.
He's fine.
Uh-oh. I haven't seen it yet, so I can't comment on...
Christian Bale is good. Amy Adams is good. The two of them are very good.
What about Steve Carell?
Steve Carell is not good. Steve Carell is literally the same stupid character in every movie he's in. I don't want to get into it.
What a Foxcatcher?
I still haven't seen Foxcatcher.
Oh, okay. Well... let's not say that just yet, sir. But yeah, the PGA announced last week, and to me, this was the nail in the coffin. Let me rephrase that. The nail was inserted into the coffin before the final hammer. The final hammer was the Golden Globes, but this PGA nomination, Bohemian Rhapsody, guys, it looks like it's a thing.
Yeah,
Bohemian Rhapsody looks like it's a thing. Somehow, some way, this big disconnect between what the critics were saying and then kind of what the guilds and the pundits were going for. They're going hard for Bohemian Rhapsody so far.
I'm a little curious about that, because there's a few films on here that just aren't... They're not your normal Best Picture nominees. And I just wonder if we're going to have a tiny field this year.
Like... 8 or like maybe like 7, because it is a preferential ballot sliding scale type of thing. Yeah. So it's totally possible.
Because I don't see Crazy Rich Asians being a Best Picture nominee. I just don't see that happening.
No, I mean, if anything, because this is the PGA, they'll always throw that one. Last year was Wonder Woman. They'll always throw that one film into the mix that has made a lot of money and was critically well-received, and that in this case was Crazy Rich Asians. Made a lot of money, well-received, mm-hmm. and they threw that in there. Quiet Place is also, on the other hand, I think has a better shot than Crazy Rich Asians. But then let's not forget, Crazy Rich Asians not only got a Golden Globe, it got a SAG, it got a PGA.
Yeah, no, but I'm still just, I don't know.
Shocked. Yeah.
It was like... Sorry, Malcolm.
I mean, on the other hand, like, as we'll probably get into for the Golden Globes anyway, all this backlash that suddenly sprung up over Bohemian Rhapsody winning, could that factor into the nominations as well for the Oscars?
What was that, Abe?
Yes.
Unequivocally, yes.
Yes. Not quite.
I don't think that Academy voters care about film Twitter.
No, that's true. But what I do think they, well, it depends. Because if the backlash is big enough and it transcends film Twitter, then yeah. If you got the media start reporting on that type of stuff, like saying they're enabling Bryan Singer, who Bryan Singer is not helping them out by any way. You saw what he's
posting the shit.
Yeah,
out.
Like,
I saw his Twitter, his Instagram, and that guy is proud of that film.
Yes, he is.
I mean, he has the right to it. He directed a ton of it, but like,
I think it's a little harsh that he didn't get a thanks yesterday.
The moment they do that, they're going to get this either uncomfortable silence from the room or maybe a couple of boos.
I think that would have happened.
Look at James Franco the year before. Like, after he won the Golden Globe, a lot of controversy came out and the Oscars sort of overlooked him or something.
True. Yeah, that was a big moment of just... Last year was a Disaster Artist, correct?
Yeah.
Or was it 2 years ago?
It was last year.
Okay. Yeah. I could see Bohemian Rhapsody... it's going to be really hard to see it miss at this point because it's literally getting everything it needs out of nowhere.
Yeah.
But what really shocked me was... Well, it shouldn't have shocked me because Beale Street is not making any money. But it's showed up in... It's been kind of like neglected, which is really sad, because now that I've seen it, I really want it to do well. It's turning into First Man, except supporting actors is sticking. PGA is kind of like a big indicator for what we do expect, because Golden Globes, as we'll talk about, is not... There's no crossover between... But it's perception is what anything else. What the headlines are saying... What you can run for your campaign, because now they can say Bohemian Rhapsody, winner of the Golden Globe, 2 Golden Globes, they can run that. You okay, Abe?
Every time you mention it, it's like, really?
Yes, really, really.
I mean, I have no problem with Rami Malek.
I can get behind that.
Great in the movie. I just have a problem with best. I mean, it's a Hollywood for press, but like best drama, like really.
Yeah. It's easily the weakest out of those 5. And it's Golden Globes. But anyway, this is not the Golden Globes. We're not there yet. We're going to move right on to what came out next. WGA. You have that up, Abe?
Yes.
All right. What do we get nominated?
Original screenplay, which I believe someone said that the favorite was not eligible, right?
It was ineligible. Correct. Yes.
Yeah. So we have 8th Grade, Green Book, A Quiet Place, Roma and Vice. And adapted, we have Black Klansman, Black Panther, Can You Ever Forgive Me, If Beale Street Could Talk, and A Star Is Born.
Those are 10 really, like, except for Vice, those are 10 really good nominees.
I'm also surprised because usually there's a lot more stuff that's ineligible. This is the first year we only had like one major contender that was not eligible. Mm-hmm. So that was a shock.
Why was that? Why...
You need to be like the writer needs to be like a part of the WGA. I'm not entirely sure what they deem ineligible. And you have to be like a member, I believe. Don't quote me on that.
Yeah. I mean, I'm confident the favorite will get an Oscar nomination, but what do you knock out for that nomination?
I think for original, you kick A Quiet Place or Vice.
Yeah. I know which one Ryan wants to kick out.
Yeah.
He did it again, guys. He did it again.
Bob Burnham has been showing up like in every single category of original screenplay with 8th Grade, Green Book, like it just won last night, and Roma Quaran the same. So it's A Quiet Place or Vice, which Vice has been a little bit iffy in some of the nominations it has gotten. But like, I think McKay already has an Oscar for writing.
So, he does.
So then...
Yeah, they might like him enough.
Get nominated. Yeah.
Vice
Wait, Ryan, hold on.
Category.
You cut out like since the beginning.
Cares about quality.
All I heard was you cares about quality. Everything we lost you for like a whole 10 seconds.
I said they're gonna kick out A Quiet Place from this category. That's the movie that's going.
There we go. We heard that.
But it's going.
Yeah. Although there's always that couple surprises in the category somewhere. Maybe Quiet Place is one of those, and it kicks out maybe Eighth Grade or something, which maybe not get in at this point, but it's been doing really well in like other categories so far. We'll go into a little bit more what this means for Oscars going forward. Any last thoughts with WGA?
I'm fairly confident this might be the five we have for adapted screenplay. Because I mean, with Logan getting into adapted last year, it's kind of opened them up to letting comic books into the screenplay now. So
go ahead.
Yeah, usually nominates a comic book movie because I remember Guardians of the Galaxy, the first one was nominated. Deadpool was. So it's like they like them. They find that we're good. The Oscar voters that don't cross over much with the WGA.
Yeah, although considering, you know, it's, you know, Black Panther is doing so well, WJ just feels like another notch it can have on its belt before it gets to the Oscars, because if it's doing this well, even though adapted screenplay is still very, is adapted screenplay the, I can't remember, is it original or adapted that's very, like, thick right now with the... I'm trying to remember.
I think original is very thick. I think there's a lot of original contenders.
Okay.
I'm trying to think of something else that could appear adapted, and I really can't. I mean, at this point, I can't think of any other that's noticeably missing from adapted.
Yeah, we'll do some investigation.
Because First Band's probably not going to get in anymore.
Yeah,
the spaceship's already sailed on that.
The spaceship is lost. we have lost it.
Pretty much.
Sadly. Although, we'll get into the Golden Globes, it's not dead yet. It's not dead yet. And, Malcolm, what do we have for the cinematographer? I'm not dead yet. No, you're almost dead. What do we have for the American cinematographer? The American Society of Cinematographers.
Yeah, I mean, so this for cinematographers for theatrical releases, Alfonso Cuarón for Roma. We've got Matthew Leibetic for A Star Is Born, Robbie Ryan for The Favourite, Linus Sangren for First Man, and Lucas Zhao for Cold War.
Cold War, wow. That was a shock. I've not seen that.
No. It's supposed to be really good.
It is.
Yeah. Isn't it? It's now you have two foreign language films in black and white that are nominated for.
Ooh.
Look at that. Look at that over there. Was that on purpose? I don't know. Also, I'm really sad James Laxton missed because that cinematography in Beale Street is. Yeah, exactly. We did it at the same time. Me and Ryan literally did the same motion of just like this mwah, beautiful motion at the same time. It's so good cinematography. Like, only thing, First Man, I don't know, only think about it more.
Yeah.
But yeah, didn't this guy do Ida like a couple years ago in another foreign language film? Do you guys know
I don't know, but I remember it was nominated.
I remember that.
Nominated for Best Cinematography.
It was. Which was like very shocking because I don't remember. We might have two foreign language films in cinematography, which has never happened before. Because this is a good indicator for the cinematography at least, because you know only the branches vote on what gets nominated for their branches, and then it's opened up to the entire Academy once you know the nominations have been officially announced and the voting period opens for them. Yeah. So this could be a nice. Out of the curveball shot, because I'm still looking for some curveballs come Oscar nomination morning. Those are always a fun thing, and this would be a fun one at the expense of James Laxton. I'm not feeling it.
Yeah. Well, the Gold Derby odds do have Beale Street in there.
Good.
Versus this, which is interesting.
Yeah.
Good, but interesting.
That's true, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, Beale Street could easily knock out First Man, maybe, for the cinematographers, but...
I think Cold War is dropping out.
If something's going to drop, it's going to be Cold War, because the first thing you talk about, Burroma, is it's his cinematography.
Oh, yeah.
And its direction, so I think there's no question about it. I just want to mention The Favorite in cinematography. I hate it so much. I don't think it works in film. It's whenever he caught it, like, it lose me for a second. Can we please don't do that in film? Film should be with, like, this wide screen of 1x2.78. I think it's the standard. Yeah. So, thank you.
It just reminds me of this awkward GoPro shot. Not a fan.
Yeah, it's so weird. Like, why would you do that? Like, I don't think it'd work in the movie. Like, it's just get a fucking small lens. Get a 17, a 15, and shut the... Oh, no, it's just... Oh, sorry. I was wrong. Get a 70 lens and put it in front on your beautiful, because the sets were beautiful. The art direction was flawless in my opinion.
No, yeah.
But that cinematography did not help.
I even enjoy the cinematography, except for the fisheye parts. I really thought that Robbie, what's the guy's name? Malcolm, what's the guy's name? You have it up, right? Robbie Ryan, okay. I thought he did a very good job. Just when the fisheye parts came on, they were very jarring. Because I thought, oh wow, I'm watching a movie.
It was a choice.
It was a bold choice that Yorgos Lanthimos likes to do, and that reminds me, oh yeah, I'm watching a Yorgos Lanthimos movie, for better or for worse.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing I was thinking about before these awards is this the first time a foreign language film has gotten so much love at the Oscars? It's looking like Roma's going to get a lot of love this year. So,
What were you saying, Abe?
I don't know, finish. I'm thinking.
Okay, the last foreign language film to get this much like attention would be Amour, which was like, because it got Best Director, it got Best Picture, it got Best Actress. It got a lot, and then it got a lot of below the line, but it got a lot above the line. So that's the closest thing, but it's different because it wasn't by the same director, like as big as Coron.
Life
is Beautiful.
Life is Beautiful. Life is Beautiful would probably be the biggest.
Yeah, well, I mean, that was 98, but which was...
I don't remember following the rest of Amor, but I don't remember, like, being pushed, like, all the way, like, Roma is. Like, you saw Amor, like, in best foreign in every single...
Well, Netflix really wants to win.
Yes.
I think that's why we're hearing so much about Roma, is because Netflix really wants to win.
Because they are marketing... And just think about it. Let's not forget, if they get nominated, this would be the first movie of Netflix to get into Best Picture.
Mm-hmm.
Might even have a shot to win, which was crazy because I would not have thought that like a couple months ago. But here we are.
Green Book is gonna win.
After it's a long night, way.
I'm thinking
it's the Golden Globes. Let's not go too crazy.
Yeah, but I like Peter Farrelly. I like him, so I hope he wins. Just keep quiet on the Oscar for directing, and he can win whatever he wants.
I was about to say, don't give him the
no.
I mean, if the Golden Globes have proved anything is possible to win, even
anything.
The
I mean, I know the Golden Globes, but like they usually get it right. Whatever you want to say about them, like they usually get the best picture right, like they award it. So,
well, I mean, one trend I have noticed is that the person who wins Best Actor Drama has quite often been the one to win. The best actor at the Golden Globes, because I think whatever year Matthew McConaughey won, he won the Globe as well. And I think
there's a lot of true. There's a lot of correlation, but at the same time, usually it's because there's a big front runner that year, and we still don't have a front runner this year. I think in my mind, because until SAG, once if Rami wins SAG, and or Cooper or whomever, if Cooper wins SAG, then that'll be like a fun. You know, we're going to get really fun here. But if Rami wins the SAG, then you,
Big was going to win SAG.
Oh, you're calling it?
No, I just think so. So just so we can get a mess of a race. Like, we don't know what's happening.
Yeah. Although in saying that, when the race was between Eddie Redmayne and Michael Keaton for Birdman and Fear of Everything, wasn't it a case of one of them won at Golden Globes, the other one at the Oscars? I might be misremembering it.
No, because it was Berman was a comedy.
Yeah, so they both won the Golden Globes.
Yeah. DiCaprio and McConaughey, both of them won that night.
Yeah, Redman won BAFTA, and then Keaton won Critics' Choice Awards. And then
every single award for them.
Yeah, and then I believe SAG was also Eddie Redmayne, which was kind of very big.
Yeah, that one he won because he worked. He was kissing the babies.
He was
taking hands.
He wanted it.
Yeah.
Although he had I'm not gonna lie, I still love his Oscar speech. It was the first time I ever felt someone was genuinely like, oh, I just won an Oscar. Like, he was enjoying it.
What about Cuba Gooding Jr.?
Oh, yeah.
Or Robert Benigni.
I didn't watch that one live. Okay, I'm not that old. I haven't watched it for that long, as much as Brooklyn Kearns like to give me crap about being watching it since the dawn of time. All right, anyway, we're gonna go on to the Ace Eddies now, which is the which stands for everyone that wants to know, the Ace Eddie nominations. Why are the American Cinema Editors, the 69th annual Ace Eddie Awards, and the nominees for Film Dramatic are Black Klansman, Bohemian Rhapsody. Oh, Live Aid was done well, I'll give them that. Tom Cross for First Man. How about that? Roma, Alfonso Cuarón, and A Star is Born. Best edited feature film comedy, Crazy Rich Asians, Deadpool 2, The Favorite, Green Book, and Vice. Best animated feature film edited, Incredibles 2, Isle of Dogs, Spider-Man into the Spider-Verse. And edited documentary, RPG, Free Solo, Three Identical Strangers, Won't You Be My Neighbor? Which is like, as Ryan was saying, that's your four.
Yeah.
Before we started recording, that is your four right there. And the rest don't pertain to us. They're all TV. This is not a TV podcast, guys. We don't care. We don't care about TV here.
So I'm curious if my streak is going to stay alive. So this would make it a three-peat, I believe, if it's not a four-peat. But it's definitely a three-peat if... First Man is able to pull this editing award out of my favorite film of the year being the one that wins best editing.
Oh, okay. See, well,
Dunkirk and Hacksaw Ridge.
You have, haven't you? Although this could be, what would really be interesting is so far, I believe not every year, but we've had at least one film nominated for, maybe it was only Baby Driver. Maybe? Where there was one film that was just nominated and it was not in Best Picture, but it made it to editing. So yeah, last year we had I, Tonya, which made it into Best Editing. The year before, Baby Driver. So this First Man could be the movie to get in without Baby Best Picture nomination.
I, Tonya, and Baby Driver
were the same year. Oh, okay. Yeah, well, see,
they were both
there you go. Okay.
I think I, Tonya was in Best Picture, though.
No, it was.
It was not. I remember because I was like, I predicted and I got it wrong.
Ha!
That was me.
I love that movie.
Oh, okay. That's why you bowed at me about Allison Janney. Laurie Metcalf all the way. And at this point, that was good for First Man. Not great for Beale Street. Nothing too crazy. I mean, awesome thing for A Quiet Place. I love seeing... Wait, that wasn't nominated. My bad.
I was not nominated.
No, I was about to say. Wait a minute, because it literally was really funny. I was looking at my screen, and it had the PGA, and I said it out loud, and I'm like, wait a minute, did it get nominated? So I had like second guess everything.
I'm just surprised Deadpool 2 got in for comedy though.
It's probably a thin year for comedy. Yeah. There's always that one that's.
I mean, look, it was better edited than Vice was, and Vice somehow got nominated. So, you know, and that's not, I'm not even comment about the movie Vice, but the editing was terrible. How it was nominated for best editing is beyond me.
I agree with that editing wasn't that, like, I think it worked with The Big Short, but like, it really did not work with Vice. Even.
No, it was inept.
I mean, now I see it now just to see where this lands.
You're gonna be in the middle, like I'm on the far right.
It's fine. It's okay. I feel like I might be reversed. Yeah, no, that's pretty much it. Also, fun fact, Star is Born is the one film so far to have gotten everything for the guilds. Everything. From SAG, PGA, Ace Eddies, WGA, American Society of Cinematographers, and I believe Art Direction. Ryan, do you have that up?
The Art Directors Guild? The Art Directors.
What got nominated?
Which they divide into, like, types of movie. So for period film, they nominated The Ballad of Buster Scruggs, Bohemian Rhapsody, The Favorite, First Man, and Roma. For Best Fantasy Art Direction, they did Black Panther, Fantastic Beasts, The Crimes of Grindelwald, The House with a Clock in Its Walls, Mary Poppins Returns, and Ready Player One. For contemporary film, they did A Quiet Place, A Star is Born, Crazy Rich Asians, Mission Impossible, Fallout, and Welcome to Marwen. And for animated film, they did Dr. Seuss's The Grinch, Incredibles 2, Isle of Dogs, Ralph Breaks the Internet, and Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse.
Wait, no Infinity War for fantasy? Or is that, did I miss that?
You did not miss that. Infinity War was not on their fantasy list.
I think Black Panther should be.
And yet Fantastic Beasts 2 got in. Okay.
Fantastic Beasts 2 and The House with a Clock in Its Walls.
God, that movie is terrible. Nobody should watch it.
And they're not. Remember, this is not quality of the film. This is the quality of the sets.
I did enjoy both Fantastic Beasts 2 and House with the Clock in the Wall, but the Infinity War sets should have been a bit better than both.
I mean, most of them are digital sets.
I was about to say, most of them are CGI, isn't it?
Yeah, I think,
to be honest, I would, even though I think the movie is kind of okay, I would probably give that to Mary Poppins Returns of the fantasy films.
I would agree.
The direction in that movie is great.
Yes, it is.
It may be exactly the same movie as the first one, but, you know, c'est la vie.
I agree with that. And I adore this film. I totally agree with that. It's a beautiful trip down memory lane / recreation of what they did, and it's still gorgeous for the set specifically. Yeah.
I have to ask, with Mary Poppins out of PGA, is it getting a Best Picture?
Not after. If it got PGA, it would probably be in there, but because I could see that getting in more. See, was it weird to say I can see it getting in more than Crazy Rich Asians? Not now, but before PGA came out. Is it weird to say that? Yeah. Because Crazy Rich Asians had all this other stuff, but Mary Poppins didn't.
No, I can see what you're talking about.
Because this Mary Poppins Returns seems like something the Academy would go for more than Crazy Rich Asians over.
It has a little more Academy legacy, I guess.
Yes. Yes. Thank you. That's it, Ryan. That's the word. I don't want to say it's out because anything can change, but at this point, it's going to be a lot of below-the-line stuff in Emily Blunt.
Mm-hmm.
Like, sound mixing, score, maybe song, and then Blunt. Yeah. Oh, and production design. Visual throwing
effects,
that in there.
I think the visual. I actually think that should win visual effects. Thing was
really.
Yeah, they were they weren't spectacular, but they were
flawless. On the shortlist for best visual effects.
I don't think it was. Was it?
It is. It is. That's why. Okay. I felt it's flawless. Whatever I think about the movie, the visual effects are flawless.
I did not think about that. I might have to look at that the visual effects again when I see it for the fifth time.
I mean the. On the other hand, a lot of people might go, well, the visual effects is the same as the original. They didn't really do anything new with them, so they may...
True.
That's true. They really didn't.
No, it was more, it was more a trip down memory lane than anything else, and more an homage to...
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Art past.
Do you want me to
clean up the traps?
Yeah. What was that, Ryan?
Oh, no, go ahead.
Well, I mean, the thing is, it didn't bother me because of the time period it was set in. It was set in the 30s, so it wouldn't have made sense if they tried to do it into the new 3D visuals. So for the period it's set in, the 2D one, what made complete sense.
Yeah, no, I'm just saying, because it was done... Was the original Mary Poppins, nominated for?
a lot of
Oscars. The original one for best visual effects.
Yeah. Okay. Then it might, if there is love from the people that still may be alive.
With Returns, they got a few people out of retirement to work on that animated sequence. Mm-hmm.
I didn't know that, which I love the animated sequence. Possibly. It's not other one possibility to be nominated. It's just not one where it's like, yes, it's a surefire thing. It's definitely not a surefire thing.
Yeah.
The only blockbuster that's a surefire thing at this moment is, say it with me, everybody, Black Panther. There you go.
Yeah.
At this point. Which is still crazy to think about.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, I think Mary Poppins Returns was nominated for the Golden Globe. If it won the Golden Globe, do you think it would have had a better shot to get into Best Picture?
Yes. Not because of the crossover, but just to show it would have some more punch now that it could use in those marketing tools. It could have something to show for itself. And then people could go out and watch it again, because it's not making as much money as I thought it was going to make.
No.
It's not doing badly for itself, though.
It's not.
Yeah. I mean, I think it's more because of when it was released, because it wasn't the first week was in competition with Aquaman and Bumblebee. I mean, and more people are probably going to see a superhero movie over Mary Poppins, so.
Yeah. I guess that makes sense. I thought that
Mary Poppins was going to bury Aquaman.
No, but I thought it was going to beat it at the box office, but nope, they got second.
I thought Aquaman was going to do nothing, but evidently I was very wrong on that.
Oh, Ryan, you were so very, very wrong.
This was
about to crack a billion.
Do you want me to clean up the scraps for a few different things that we didn't touch on?
Oh, what other guilds did we not touch up on?
So we did not touch on the documentaries or the animated films from the PGAs. And then we have the documentary DGAs.
I forgot they announced those. Go ahead. Let's look through those guys.
Okay. So going back to the DGAs, the first thing we talked about, for documentary motion pictures, they nominated The Dawn Wall, Free Solo, Hal, Into the Okavango, RBG, Three Identical Strangers, and Won't You Be My Neighbor.
Could you repeat that other one again? What was that called? Into the
Okavango.
Okay. All right.
I don't know. I had never heard of it before. I'm surprised that Minding the Gap and Shirkers aren't on here instead of these other things that I've never heard of. But all right. And then they also do animated films at the PGAs, which they nominated The Grinch, Incredibles 2, Isle of Dogs, Ralph Breaks the Internet, and Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse.
So we have, which is basically your, the same amount of, your usual suspects, we'll say, we have for the animated.
Yeah, but I think Mariah is probably going to get that fifth spot instead of the Grinch.
Oh, yeah. I mean,
If the Grinch gets in, it's going to be the boss baby of this year.
Yes.
Except the Grinch is a lot better than the Boss Baby.
I still have yet to see the Grinch. I need to give that a try sometimes.
I haven't seen it either, so I can't comment on the quality.
Terrible.
And then to clean up another category, the DGA, who for some reason announces their documentaries and commercials and TV on a day before they nominate their films. They nominated Morgan Neville for Won't You Be My Neighbor? Rammel Ross for Hail County This Morning, This Evening.
There he is.
Chai, Vassar Helyi, and Jimmy Chan for Free Solo. Tim Wardle for Three Identical Strangers, and Betsy West and Julie Cohen for RBG.
What I was telling Ryan, go ahead, Malcolm.
For that one, I'm surprised Michael Moore didn't get in there for directing.
Oh,
documentary?
Not surprised at all. That movie has not been forgotten. I mean, if he had gotten in, it would be a nice resurgence, but it's definitely not going to go places as much as people thought it was.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't think it was going places. I'm just surprised he didn't get for the DGAs anyway.
I mean, I'm pretty sure he's been nominated before, so they were in any rush to give him another nomination. I do think this is like, as I was telling, we were talking about this before we started recording. You have the four usual suspects in Free Solo, RBG, Three Identical Strangers, and the person way out in the front right now, well, maybe not way out, but a good amount in front, is Won't You Be My Neighbor until otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
Until we're proven otherwise.
Yeah.
I think I need to go see Free Solo in a theater, which is going to scare the living shit out of me.
Oh, it's terrifying. It's wonderful.
For the listeners who don't know me, I have a fairly crippling fear of heights. So a movie like Free Solo has not driven me to it.
That's true. I wouldn't see it then.
I was actually thinking about this the other day when they announced the title of the Mr. Rogers biopic that's coming out this year.
Yeah.
This could be the first time that 2 years in a row they're seeing some Mr. Rogers thing in the Oscars, depending on how good A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood actually is going to be.
Maybe. I still can't get over seeing Tom Hanks as Mr. Rogers, because I'm just looking at seeing Tom Hanks, and I'm not. I
it's been directed by the person that direct Can You Ever Forgive Me and something about the teenage girl, Diary.
Mm. Oh,
it's the same person, Maria something. I don't remember her name. Sorry,
Maria Heller.
Yeah, she's directing.
Or Maria Heller, something like that. And that is all the loose ends that have been tied up, because we are going to move right on. You guys have been waiting with bated breath. This is the thumbnail. The Golden Globes, 2019 Golden Globes, or 2018. It's really the 2018, because it's celebrating the 2018 year, but it takes place in 2019. So, math. But this year, the Golden Globes have officially reached an all-time low. Actually, just kidding. They nominated The Tourist just to get Johnny Depp and Angelina Jolie there. They're not that low just yet. do you guys remember that?
Yeah.
Like 2009, I think what it was. They nominated it in Best Picture, Musical Comedy.
Yep.
that was a trip. But we've recently just had the Golden Globes, hosted by Sandra Oh and Andy Samberg. What did you guys think of them hosting in general? Any thoughts?
I didn't like it. I mean, their hosting was like they were trying to be all PC and like make jokes about people by not making jokes about them. Mm-hmm. The whole flu shot segment thing didn't work.
Yeah.
I mean, the one joke I liked is the Jim Carrey bit they did at that the was... start.
That was that's cute. Because Jim Carrey is funny.
Yeah.
And I mean, that is like, I mean, I do wish he won for the TV show he did, because he was really good in it, but that's beyond another, that's another topic for another day.
I also really liked the what joke was it, the one about Aloha, and you heard in the back Emma Stone saying I'm sorry. That I love that.
I didn't watch the full ceremony because.
But Emma Stone made that funny though.
Exactly. Like, exactly. You notice a pattern here?
Yeah. Look, they made the case for the Oscars not having a host. That was how bad that was.
Wow.
Painfully unfunny, and just like it was like, what are you doing here?
Which is sad, because I genuinely think that they're funny individuals outside of their hosting that they did. Andy Samberg, yeah. I really enjoy. Sandra Oh, the few things I've seen her in comedy-wise, I've really enjoyed her. It just, well, there was...
They were walking on eggshells about everything.
Yeah.
Like, they really just need Ricky Gervais back to give them, like, a talking to.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
So Hollywood people need a tongue-lashing.
Yeah, a tongue lashing. That's a new one.
I mean, the one thing I did like is when Sandra Oh sort of did the big speech about Me Too and stuff. I mean, like, well, yeah, it's beyond past the Me Too movement now, but it's like she did the whole impassioned speech about being scared, being up there, and all that. So,
yeah, Mm-hmm. That was inspiring. It was just good, just like the monologue. I don't know. It was definitely very lackluster. We'll say that.
Yeah,
it could have been. Because I will never forget, like, when we had Tina Fey and Amy Poehler. The two of them had great chemistry. I love what they did. And
yeah,
can we have them back, please?
I don't know. Yeah. I mean, I think it. I don't know what it was. It was like alien pod people took over the bodies of Andy Samberg and Sandra Oh, and they were just being something completely different, as if they're being told from higher ups, like, you can't say this, you can't do this.
I think that's honestly the state of the world that we're in today. We're in a world where if you say anything that's a little bit out of line, you're just, you know, anathema, and they're going to have a go at you. And they seem so afraid to make a joke. And so they just tried to find ways to tiptoe around it and try and make a joke. But then the joke isn't funny because you can't make the joke that you want to make.
The best joke of the night was when Cuaron went to stage and said, like, after Harrison Ford and Jeff Bridges, that was the best joke of the night.
See, what was funny is those off the cuff, non-scripted moments is what really are the highlights of this. It's what you can tell that these people were reading from a script. Which really hurt. They didn't have the same amount of natural chemistry that maybe Tina Fey and Amy Poehler had, because they're best friends, so they've had to work with each other before. Yeah.
Although, I felt like Amy Poehler was cheating on Tina Fey last night.
What was that about? I did not know that was... That was like...
That was a little weird. First
off, I was about to say, Maya Rudolph, your husband would find this hilarious.
Yeah.
Because isn't she married to...
Paul Thomas Anderson?
Yeah.
That's it. That's such a... Yeah.
It's a weird couple.
It is. Yeah. Like, good for them, but wow.
Yeah, I mean, personally, I think if they got like both Andy Samberg and Terry Crews from the Brooklyn Nine-Nine hosting together, you might get a more natural sort of chemistry because they've worked together so long on the show. So
maybe.
Yeah, Terry Crews. I want more Terry Crews just in general, because I feel like he has such a great natural charisma. He would be good. I at least want to give him a try for something. Maybe not don't give him the Oscars just yet. Give him, like, you know, Gotham's, you know, work his way up. Cause I love Terry Crews. I love Terry Crews.
Give him the Gemini Awards.
The Gemini Awards. Wow. What was that name?
Who's hosting the critic choice?
Oh, ooh, that's a good question. Oh, but you know who's gonna host SAG, and I'm super excited?
Oh, Olivia Munn.
No, not Olivia Munn.
Did SAG announce a host?
Tay Diggs. I have no idea who Tay Diggs is.
That's familiar, that name. But no, Megan Mullally. Mullally? I think that's how I pronounce her name. I know her. You guys watch Parks and Recreation? Ugh. Tammy.
Hold on.
Ryan, what was that sigh? What was that sigh?
It was I've tried to watch Parks and Recreation on several
occasions. Skip season one.
And been forced to watch Parks and Recreation on several occasions. And there is Nick Offerman, and that's great. And there is sometimes Chris Pratt, which is great. And there's sometimes Rob Lowe, which is okay.
And Aubrey Plaza?
Aubrey Plaza's not funny at all. She's really...
What's less funny, Parks and Recreation or Vice?
Sorry?
What's worse, Parks and Recreation or Vice?
Vice, because, like... Okay, I'm going to just explain this briefly.
Please.
Vice, like, it treats some really good people... And this might be a little bit of personal closeness to it, but some people who I've had the pleasure of meeting or I've been secondhand connected to for a while now, it treats them like dirt and doesn't depict who these actual people are. And I find that to be very disgusting and wrong. And it does it because they have a political view or took a political stance that Adam McKay happened to not like. And, you know, whether like, I really don't care what one's political feelings are. I really don't. But you can't treat people like shit just because you disagree with them politically. And you can't depict people like they're dumb idiots just because you disagree with them politically. And I just think that it's like, it's not right. What they did in that movie is not right. And that's why I hate Vice as much as I do.
Ryan laying that down. Okay, well, now we know. I'm looking for that. I'll forgive you for not liking Parks and Rec now.
Parks and Rec does not have that problem.
Okay, good.
I don't find Amy Poehler funny.
So, okay.
A big part of Parks and Rec is not good for me.
That's so fair. You don't like Megan... Wait, what?
You don't like Sisters?
I never saw Sisters.
Who saw Sisters? I saw Sisters.
Sorry, I was busy watching a movie that made a little bit more money than Sisters.
Yeah, Star Wars, cough.
Which is really nice.
Yeah, but no. Anyway, no. Megan Mullally, she played the character Nick Offerman's ex-wife, Tammy.
She's pretty funny in Will and Grace too.
I've not seen Will and Grace before, but I just fell in love with her there, and I love anything with Nick Offerman and her. They do a lot of funny commercial and video stuff together. Mm. They're a funny couple, so I'm really excited to see what she can do. So that's a good host. But speaking of hosts, where's our Oscar host?
We still don't have one.
Do we see them anywhere? Can we find them?
I told you, we'll probably find out what the nominations are now.
Okay. A while back, a couple episode 13, I believe, or 14, not sure. Yeah, 13. It was 13. Around the 11-minute mark, we talked about we were going to place bets. And we never really bet anything, kind of maybe more bragging rights. Abe said we'd find out by New Year's. I said we'd find out by Christmas Day, because that's way too late. And then Malcolm said not by nominations. So far, Malcolm looks like he's on track to win, because Abe and I can't win at this point unless we go back in time. And Abe, you have not discovered time travel, have you?
I was talking about Chinese New Year.
Which is when?
Like in March.
A+.
February, I believe.
Yeah, it's the end of January or beginning of February.
Okay, so.
Oh my. If you. I'm going to give that to you just because if that happens, I'm going to just die of laughter. The Golden Globes, guys, happened this past week. So, okay, we're going to go through the quick nominations. We're going to do only. Or the wins, excuse me. We're going to go through the movies. The TV, care less about that. I'm sure that some great things happen, but we do not watch TV. But we're going to start off with Best Original Song, Motion Picture, and the second most predictable win of the night. And that is Shallow, A Star Is Born. And also, can we talk about how gorgeous Lady Gaga looked tonight? Wow, I love that night.
She was dressed normal.
She was indicative of Judy Garland from A Star Is Born. They had a really cool combination of there, and it worked perfectly. Mark Ronson gave a great speech, very heartfelt. Give Shallow the Oscar. Let's move on.
Yeah.
And one of my favorite wins of the night. I didn't see this coming, honestly, because I was at work, and then I found out via someone texting me, or via group chat. But Best Original Score, Motion Picture, Justin Hurwitz, First Man.
Hell yeah.
Wow. Yes, please. Yeah. Yes, please. Do I prefer Beale Street Score? They're close. Man, it's a lot of Beale Street First Man closeness.
was Beale Street nominated at the Globes?
It wasn't. It was not. But
no, so it wouldn't have won anyway.
It wouldn't. But I mean, like, in general, which, looking into Oscars, we'll see how that is. But this show's First Man is not dead yet. There's some below the line love that it's not forgotten, which I'm happy about.
Mm-hmm.
Most predictable win of the night. Best picture, foreign language film, Roma.
Indeed.
Moving on. Best motion picture animated, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Wow. Okay. Sorry. First off, I'm sorry, Ryan.
Nobody predicted that. Like,
No, well,
I did a gold derby.
I was about to say,
I think it's been in a very close, I think ever since it's come out, it's been in a close race with Incredibles 2. And I think that's probably what the decision is going to come down to.
Oh, but absolutely.
I think the Academy is going to go Incredibles 2 just because they have so many more Pixar people in the Academy
at
this point. But we'll see.
I don't know. It's probably going to, because I think if Spider-Man keeps getting the wins over everything else, it's going to push its likelihood up more and more.
Yeah.
Oh no.
Every critic's award, like almost every single critic's award. So
yeah, it's either been that or like Incredibles 2, basically most of the time. Yeah. But if Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse can take this momentum and push the narrative toward like a BAFTA win, a PGA win, if it gets like more than just and gives Incredibles a run for its money, we might have a front runner. But this is kind of shocking because
win the guilds, then great. I mean, good for it. I'm happy for that movie. It's very good.
Yeah.
So
did that hurt to say, Ryan, or
no? They're both in my top 10 right now. As a matter of fact, so I'm not really that hurt by either one.
Okay, I'm making sure. All right, and going on to best. Oh, what was it, Malcolm? Before we moved on.
I mean, I do want to see another year in which it's not a Pixar one.
Yeah, no, that'd be an interesting year. Best screenplay, motion picture, Green Book.
Told you, I got it right. That one's the protest.
You did.
For a selection, because
I had it third in out of the five of my predictions. I don't know why I just couldn't picture them going Green Book, and then they went hard for Green Book.
I mean, it seems like a Golden Globes movie. I mean, like,
what is a Golden Globes movie?
Bohemian Rhapsody.
Just like a Golden Globes movie. You know it when you see it.
But okay, well, that's true. I mean, after the one best drama, I can agree with that. And Green Book continues to love again for best supporting actor when Mahershala Ali won for Green Book. I switched last minute, so I'm glad about this because he did not win for Moonlight. Correction from one of our viewers last week. I somehow said, oh, he totally won for Moonlight. But no, he did not steamroll through the competition. It was Aaron Taylor Johnson winning for Nocturnal Animals out of nowhere.
Oh, yeah, that was awesome.
Yeah. I know. I do agree. That was a nice out of nowhere pick, which I really enjoyed. Even though I preferred Mahershala Ali's performance in Moonlight, that was a fun, great reminder for Nocturnal Animals, which was the movie that still is underseen to this day.
I guess you could say you didn't see that coming.
I did not see that coming. I didn't. Wow. Did not see that coming? That was good. That was good.
Well done.
That was excellent timing. Excellent timing.
We have to applaud this dad joke.
That was, bravo. Good job, Malcolm. Good job. Everyone, a moment of silence for this amazing joke. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Moving on. Mahershala, this is his first Golden Globe, so I was like, yeah, they're going to give it to him when I've realized that, because...
So, you know, he's the most obvious pick in this category. You know, when you look at it, like Richard E. Grant, great. You know, he was fine. Timothée Chalamet, actually, really, you know, he's getting awards attention, but it's still a really underrated performance of Beautiful Boy. Just because Steve Carell ruins that movie does not mean that Timothée Chalamet is not giving it his all.
Woo! Woo!
Have you watched Welcome to Marwen?
I have not watched Welcome to Marwen, and I wasn't going to.
It's not in any awards contention. He's not going to see it.
It looks really creepy.
It does, doesn't it?
But like, it looks creepy as well.
When I eventually do my Zemeckis watch through, which I will get to, will watch it. But
not now. Best performance by an actress in a supporting role in a motion picture. Wow, Regina King. If Beale Street could talk. So
I'm surprised she won the Globe.
I was very surprised she won the Globe. Abe, didn't you say Amy Adams was going to start her...
Yes.
So, I'm honestly shocked too. I honestly thought that Well, we'll get into the most Golden Globes thing they could have done. This was not the most Golden Globes thing they could have done, because Amy Adams was nominated for two things, Sharp Objects and this, and lost both. I thought she would have gotten this. I didn't predict her. I was going on a limb and say one of the favorite girls would get it. Nope. They went with Regina King. This is going to make SAG really interesting. It's going to make the Oscars interesting.
Yeah.
I mean, do we have like a... Oh, what was that?
Was Regina King nominated in SAGs, or was she left out?
No. She was left out, which is shocking. Considering... yeah.
I cannot comment on Bill's
speech. Well, but we got Emily Blunt. So...
Yeah.
But...
Yeah. I mean, the question is, with the Golden Globe, and does that put her back into the race for the Oscars?
For Regina King, it does, but I don't think for the actual film.
Yeah, that's what I was meaning.
No, I still thought she was going to be nominated regardless, because she's been doing, the movie has a lot of love for that performance. But this one shows she could, in fact, go back and win it, because year was it? Regina King could possibly win it, depending on how, if she gets critics, if she gets possibly BAFTA, we could have a competition on our hands.
Well,
it's possible.
If you look at the SAG Awards and who they as much as I want Emily Blunt to be nominated, I'm pretty sure she's not going to be as much. And I haven't seen Mary Queen of Scots yet. In supporting actress. We'll get to Mary Poppins and another thing. But as much as I would like her to be nominated for A Quiet Place, I don't think that's going to happen. And yeah. Mary Queen of Scots, who is talking about Mary Queen of Scots?
I've heard much is about either the costumes and the score.
Or this random Margot Robbie nomination at the SAG Awards.
I haven't heard terrible. Yeah, I haven't heard terrible things about it. It's just like I haven't heard.
It's just kind of anything about it. Whatever.
Yeah, I know. Which I still need to see, because apparently it's fine and pretty good, but nothing like.
Yeah. It comes out in about a week here.
Oh, we need to go see that then. All right. Regina King just got a resurgence and is now back in the conversation for a possible win. Possible at Oscars. Possible. It's not likely. Possible. For best performance by an actor in a motion picture, musical, or comedy, cover your ears, Ryan. Christian Bale for Vice.
It's fine.
That's predicted that. We're moving on. Best performance by an actress in a motion picture, musical, or comedy, The Favorite. Olivia Colman. I'm very well deserved. I love Emily Blunt as Mary Poppins. This is a better performance. Hands down, a better performance.
Yeah, it's not my favorite in this category, but it's really good. And I'm happy that...
Can we talk about how he called Rachel Weisz and Amazon her beaker?
Yes! That was great. That was funny. But also, can we also talk about the moment when Dick Van Dyke came on stage? That was
amazing.
That was awesome. That was a really cute moment. That made me happy. So is he getting the Carol Burnett Award next year for TV? Because I feel like he should, considering the television that he did for the Dick Van Dyke Show. Considering,
The other one is we made like. I mean, as much as I hate saying it, like, he's getting up there. We don't know how much
longer. He's 92. He's 92, people.
Yeah.
Still spry. I mean, great for 92.
Manning, you're getting, like, when you talk, your mic.
One sec.
Although, while Manning's doing this, on the topic of TV for a second, while we're off the movie topic... I was amazed to find out that Chuck Lorre won his first major award in anything yesterday. I was so confused why he was so freaking out as he was giving his speech. And then I looked it up. And despite his 8 Emmy nominations, he has never won a major award.
What did he win for?
He won for the Kaminsky Method, yeah.
That's an amazing,
yeah, right? I really should see that now, because...
It's on Netflix.
As I said, with when it came to the lead actor in the comedy one, I thought Jim Carrey had it in the bag. I did not see Michael Douglas winning it at all.
Mm-hmm.
Chuck Lorre. He's from the Big Bang. Oh my god, how he hasn't won that?
I know it.
But I mean, one of my favorite lines was when you actually have in the Golden Globes Christian Bale thanking Satan.
that was funny. I have to say that was entertaining.
His whole speech was funny. Like he was just stuck in like out of nowhere. Like whatever come to his head, like he was saying it. And it's so weird because his accent, like you think like he's American, but like he has the thickest accent ever.
Yeah.
All right, we good? Am I sound better?
Yes, you sound better. You
there we go. All right. Well, they were getting off track with TV. Also, speaking of TV, the Carol Burnett Award. I'm surprised they didn't have that sooner with TV or something. But I'm glad they did because she was a very deserving win and had a great speech. Great speech.
Mm-hmm. I'm surprised Carol Burnett was the first one to win it. I mean, who saw that coming?
I know, right? I thought it was Christian Bale who was going to get the win.
Who was nominated? Steve Carell's
where he's like, and the nominees are was hilarious.
Yeah, that was great.
Although I have to say, when Andy Samberg was introducing Steve Carell to come out, like you could say it's a joke, you could say it was over the cuckoo's nest. I thought it was going to be Jack Nicholson.
Yes, yes, yeah. That was good. good reverse of all expectations. And then we're getting on to one of the shockers, I guess not the big shocker of the night, which was best performance by an actor in a motion picture drama, Rami Malek in Bohemian Rhapsody. Mm. Okay. I can get behind that.
It was either him or Bradley Cooper.
Oh,
it was going to be one of the two.
Should have been Bradley Cooper, but...
I thought like he changed his voice for the movie, but he sounds the same.
He sounds like he still has the teeth.
Yeah, he sounds exactly the same.
I think he's so used.
Like, so that degraded the performance for me. I thought like he changed something, but he sounds the same.
Have you seen him in anything before?
No, honestly.
I didn't watch Mr. Robot, so no.
Have you guys seen Short Term 12?
Nope.
Yes. But I don't remember him.
Okay, he's also in the Ninth Museum series.
Yeah.
I've
watched that.
That's
how the first
he's,
one.
Yes, he is the king.
The other thing I've technically seen is that video game that he did.
Until Dawn, fun game.
Yes,
fun game.
It was kind of cool to see Brian May and Roger Taylor there.
Yeah, that was really cool. There was a really nice photo of, I think it was Brian May and Lady Gaga talking. She was just kind of like, in awe of Brian May, which I was like, that man has great hair. So
I know this is sort of controversial, but I do actually kind of think that he should have, like, I understand why the producers didn't call out Bryan Singer when. We'll get to this movie winning later, but
spoiler.
You know, he, no matter what you kind of think of Bryan Singer, he did direct this entire performance. Basically.
He did direct it. That is very true. It's just, it would look
everything Rami Malek did in this movie, like, except for, I think it was 10% of the shoot.
Something like that
was directed by Bryan Singer. And I think that I don't know that I've ever seen an actor not thank their director in a speech before.
Yeah.
It was weird.
I mean, it does make you wonder if there's more behind the scenes thing that is not said, because there could have been a clash between Rami and Singer.
Oh, from what the allegations were, yeah. There was definitely a clash.
Like there's stories about Bryan Singer being terrible in every single set. So
yeah, it's not exactly he's the most loved, we'll say, director of all time, despite allegation stuff aside. So I'm not too surprised that there was like animosity between the two, but I guess they just wanted to try to keep Bohemian Rhapsody as low of a profile from controversy as they can. Too late now. But we'll see how that plays out, if Rami Malek might be accepting more awards as the season goes on. But Cooper should be accepting a lot more. Still the best male performance of this year, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
In my opinion. Best performance by an actor in motion picture drama. The Golden Globes did the least Golden Globes thing ever. It did not give it to Lady Gaga.
I was shocked.
I was very shocked. Did you guys have any predicted Glenn Close?
I told you Glenn Close were going
to win. Okay, yeah, of course you were. You know what?
That one, I was proud of that one because I think after I tweeted it and you like it. I think after that speech, she's winning it.
Not quite. Yes, that was a great speech.
Like that gives her the home momentum and takes Gaga away and she's going to win it and she's going to get the Oscar after 7 nominations.
Yes.
I don't know if she was nominated for Fatal Attraction, but she should have won for that movie. I don't care what she was.
I was about to say 7?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I've seen it a lot of times, people saying, like, if you give a good speech at the Golden Globes, it's going to keep you in their consciousness to get into the Oscar nomination, but to go to things. Like, that was a great speech. She'll be good sort of
nominated. If you give a good speech, they will remember you, and they'll be like in the back of your mind while they're looking through stuff. And they'll be like, oh, yeah, I remember that really heartwarming speech that she gave that.
Yeah.
Or when you forget somebody, like Stallone didn't mention Ryan Coogler in his speech. I think that lost him the Oscar, honestly.
I don't think that lost him. It might have been like, you know.
Dude, he thanked everybody. He talked about himself when Ryan Coogler was the one of the idea. Like, what the fuck you think you're doing? Sorry for swearing.
I don't know. Let's say you're fired up today, Abe.
It's going to be the 7th nomination.
Yeah.
I mean, it just goes to show that the Hollywood Foreign Press actually have seen the Wife. I mean, it's one of those. Yeah,
well, I hope they have seen The Wife. I haven't seen it, so I can't really like say
The Wife had no release. Like, it honestly did not have a release. It was supposedly released in August. I was watching movies in August. The Wife did not come out.
I couldn't
believe
Abe's the only one that saw it. Abe literally the only one that saw it.
And
I really watched it recently.
How? I mean, I'm pretty sure Jen Kemp has actually seen it as well, but she's talked about actually watching it. So
But
she's in Boston, and every weird movie comes to Boston. I had the pleasure of living there for 4 years. You get everything eventually.
Yeah, this is the plight of us not living in big cities, was to say, big like you know. Movie cities,
weird college towns.
Yeah, that's the stuff.
No, I'm surprised that they didn't go with Lady Gaga. So
it was very shocking because I thought, but it makes sense because she already won a Golden Globe that night.
Have her Star Is Born moment.
I mean, she still could, but they were probably Glenn Close. I think this if there's any of the acting categories that's gonna steamroll now, this is the one that I think might go through that, because if there's any of them, this is the one. Best director motion picture, thinking of steamroll, is this it? Is this the beginning of Quran?
Yes.
Taking everything.
Yeah, you know what's funny, like I made you guys like turn around because I say Spike Lee because Cuaron had won. Like you and Dan were thinking about Cuaron, and I just think
you made me consider changing my mind, but I did not. I only changed it from Herschel Ali, but I wanted to keep it from Cuaron because
I think Cuaron is gonna steamroll DGA Oscar.
I can see him getting DGA.
Yeah, so 5 Mexicans in 6 years.
That's
crazy. Yep. Wow. Yeah. 5, but the same, but the
oh yeah, well,
2-2-1 for the 3 amigos.
Yeah, and see Del Toro directing like another film in a year, and he's gonna win it too.
Wait for Del Toro's next film.
I mean, Del Toro, like the thing about Del Toro is that he makes a lot of movies that are not
great.
I'm not gonna say not great. He makes a lot of like not
Oscar friendly, not Oscar friendly. We'll say that.
Not that Shape of Water was particularly Oscar friendly, but
that's very true. That's very true. Which really, Pan's Labyrinth might have been more "quote unquote" Oscar friendly than an actual. Hey, speaking of a foreign language film that did really well, Pan's Labyrinth.
Yeah.
No picture, but still. And then our final two: motion picture, musical or comedy, Green Book, and motion picture drama, Bohemian Rhapsody. I remember I was watching it live. I asked in the chat, after Rami Malek won and Glenn Close won for The Wife. So what's winning picture? Because literally nothing looked like it was going to happen. And then next thing you know, they said Bohemian Rhapsody. Thoughts, guys? I have a quiet audience.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't see this coming, especially not over Star Is Born. I mean, a lot of people would argue that both this and Star Is Born should have been a musical comedy. I mean, Star Is Born, I can see the argument for why they would consider it more a musical, but Bohemian Rhapsody, I really don't consider a musical at all. But
no, yeah,
someone I've talked to online says, oh, it's Bohemian Rhapsody getting sing-along versions in Europe, so it's a musical. It's like, no.
it is Queen, but no, I just... What was that, Abe?
He said the movie's mediocre, and it will not deserve any kind of awards attention itself from Rami Malek, not even the ensemble in SAG, which is, I don't know what, Samuel, because it's a movie about one performance, and Lucy Botun, which is kind of not good. So usually I hate the one. I don't hate the movie, I just hate that Lopez K.
Yes, I agree with that.
I think it's well deserved. I think there's better films than it. A ton of better, like 40 films I can review better than that movie.
So here's the deal with this category, though. Like, here are all the different ways the Golden Globes could have spun this one. They could have picked the middle finger to Trump movie and picked Black Klansman. They could have picked the arty movie that nobody has seen, and therefore they would be unimpeachable if they picked If Beale Street Could Talk. They could have picked A Star Is Born, with two of literally the biggest stars in Hollywood and otherwise.
Yeah.
And been very Golden Globesy, and also had a movie that's pretty good and is probably going to do well for itself. Or they could have picked Black Panther, the biggest movie in this award show by a long shot. Black Panther, and the movie that like everybody's obsessed with. But no, instead they picked a different crowd pleaser. Kind of just like this weird, troubled movie that's like...
I just think they wanted them to be like Queen to be on stage. That's what they wanted.
That's very possible. But like, how much money did they pay for this? Like, how many lunches did Queen go to get this?
I have no idea. Like, what's interesting is that there had to be multiple factors. Like, a factor of Rami Malek's performance had to bring this movie along with it, because and then this movie was seen by like literally everyone. It made so much money, like unprecedented. Who thought that? It's ridiculous how much money this movie's made. And then it's just become such like people have seen it and they've talked about it. It's people will keep remembering it. And now it's like this, you know, narrative has been pushing forward for it. And now it's just kind of like somehow, I remember when it first, like, what was the first thing that it got? I guess it got the, this was the first nomination it got, like Golden Globes. And that's when people started to do a second turn.
It was SAG and then was.
Yeah.
Now PGA, you know. I think it's the highest grossing biopic of all time after the
Passion of Christ. You're right.
It's I don't understand how you have five movies in a row, like, and you pick the worst of the five. Like, literally a monkey would do better than this.
Like, ouch.
Just picking at random.
I mean, yeah,
you would do better than this.
Yeah, it just this movie just
substance. The movie's no substance. It has great music, and I think that's why a lot of people like it, because if you take the
movie, but the music was great before this movie came out.
Yeah, like if you take the music away, there's no movie. It's just a lame bio because we've seen like many.
Yeah,
like
this huge revelation.
Is the highest grossing biopic according to Box Office Mojo? What do you think is the second highest grossing?
Passion of the Christ.
Well, music biopics.
Music biopics.
No, it's not. Ray's number five. Straight Outta Compton is the second highest grossing.
Oh, really?
Walk the Line.
That's like a more American biopic, because let's be honest, they are not well known.
And apparently, some music biopic called I Can Only Imagine outgrossed Ray.
Oh wow, that's like the, I can only imagine. That's a that came out last year. Yeah, that's a Christian bio. That's a biopic of the guy who wrote I Can Only Imagine.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't have expected a Chris, like a Christian biopic, music biopic to be overweight. So,
well, that's there you go. Inflation. There you go.
Wait, where's 8 Mile? Was that not higher on this list?
Is that? It depends on if they consider it a biopic, because I mean, it's actually it's okay. Actually not. It's not on the list at all.
Okay, I guess technically the character is fictional, I mean, but it's not at all.
It's Eminem.
Yeah, I get that. They're probably not considering it a biopic. That's just see how much it actually made there. I mean, so, I know we've got it completely off topic.
I was about to say, yeah, reel it back in, gentlemen. But also counteractive to that. We have possibly our new front runner in Green Book.
Yeah, probably.
It makes sense.
I really want to know what I did. You guys hear what Mahershala Ali said yesterday? I really want to know what he said.
No.
Wait, what did he say?
He like leans into why the guy giving the speech, whose name is now escaping me. Yeah, he leans in, like reminds him to say something, and Peter Farrelly responds, "Oh yeah, definitely." But I couldn't hear what Mahershala Ali said. I was like, "What were you saying?"
I don't know.
Really don't know what he said.
Yeah, which is really funny. This movie has also had some trouble, like production, which is really fascinating because now both the two movies with more. How do I say this? A tepid reception have gotten the Golden Globes. These are also two big crowd pleasers. These are like two big feel good films. You know, there's just enough meat on there to get a fill, but nothing to overtly like marinate and ruminate on later.
I think Green Book's biggest obstacle is Universal, which is terrible company.
Mm-hmm.
Like they're not mm-hmm. like if you see their movies, look out First Man. Look at Steve Jobs. Ugh. Like they don't do a good job campaigning for their movies. So that they did good with Get Out, but that was I think that was different situation. I think that was thanks to Jason Blum. I don't think that's for Universal. I think that was Jason Blum like campaigning, and it's gonna happen with Us. I don't know if he's producing Us too.
Yeah, Jason Blum does a great job of just like you know.
Jason Blum a producer on Black Klansman?
Yeah, he is. You're right. Yeah. He's a good job of just getting out there, like putting a face to a name of producers instead of being someone like behind the scenes. He's a very active producer.
Nominations in like what 3 of 7 years or something because he got nominated in 2014 for Whiplash.
Yeah, wait, he did Whiplash? He produced it?
Yeah. Yep.
Good for him. Wow. Good for him. I mean,
he likes to be there. So,
although he also did Truth or Dare, so.
Well, you know,
they can't all be winners.
I mean, Jason Blum has made distinctly more losers than winners.
Yeah, I mean, he produces a lot.
That's his business model.
Produce a lot, maybe something will stick.
Although, on the tepid reception of Green Book, do you think that that's just our perception of it because we're more plugged into the woke film Twitter world? Because like,
it is.
I don't know that the general public / the general voting audience necessarily feels as like
100% agree
betrayed by this movie.
Oh, 100% agree. Like, I don't think they even know about Bohemian Rhapsody. They don't even know about the stuff behind the scenes. The regular audience.
Yeah, I mean the regular audience definitely know, but like even the Academy people and the Guild people.
Let me show you someone that's really good in the war season. Octavia Spencer is producer of that movie.
Oh yeah, she's
and she's really good getting nominated. She gets nominated for things that she doesn't deserve. To be honest,
she has a knack at that.
Yeah,
she does, doesn't she?
She has an actor like since The Help. She's just herself and she gets nominated. With all respect, I really like her. Yeah. But like she's really smart about doing that. Like, she got nominated for Hidden Figures and Shape of Water the last couple of years. So she's a good producer. She knows what she's doing in that circuit. So
yeah,
I think that's why Green Book, it's a good front runner right now. Well, also you have the other studio, which is amazing, that they did with Argo 6 years ago with A Star Is Born and Warner Bros.
Yeah, see, they're A Star Is Born. I don't see A Star Is Born is still, it may have taken like a hit, but it's not like, it's not sinking because it still has the most guild support out of any other place. Like Green Book, it missed a couple of key ones. And right now it is like, if it wins, it's probably going to pull like, it's going to have to be like our spotlight this year. Because I really don't see, it's going to do nothing but blow the line. And it really only has a shot right now of winning screenplay and supporting actor. I can't see winning director.
Yeah, it's not even nominated, to be honest.
Like,
I really enjoy the movie, but like, it's not.
I really had a great time watching the movie. I think it's a very, like, it is what it is. As Peter Farrelly gave a great speech about, you know, the how, you know, just supposed to be like an inclusive, you know, movie about setting people's differences aside and finding common ground, which it was the purpose of the movie, and they succeeded really well with that. Because I left it and I was feeling like, I feel really good today. Yeah. It's one of those movies, and it does and succeed in that place. But you don't really leave it and think about it as, which is the downside, I guess. But the Golden Globes remembered it when they left, because this movie got 3 wins. And I believe had the most wins of the night when it comes to movies.
Yes, correct. You're not wrong.
And then the next movie to get 2 is Roma with foreign language and director.
Bohemian Rhapsody.
And Bohemian Rhapsody. Yeah. But most of all, the love was pretty, like, felt like all around. I like it when that happens, because it keeps things a little interesting. Because didn't La La Land, like, sweep when it was in the Golden Globes?
Okay, but it swapped the musical comedy category.
Yes, no, well, yeah, you're right. It did. But it was still more
like... Which it deserved to. Like, let's be frank.
Yeah. I'm always Franks, Ryan. That's my last name. Yeah, it is, but it just kind of like, it shows like this race, even with winners in the Golden Globes, we still don't have like a clear front runner. There's no movie that's like taking over everyone else. It wasn't like La La Land last year, where it was far out and away the front runner for the longest time until it started to lose some steam.
A few years ago.
It's 2019 now. It's still weird to say. We're still only a week or so into 2019. So it's going to be really interesting to see how this continues to play out once we have a more clear picture with the race is shaping out. Because we have a nice shape, but we don't have a clear front runner. We have some people in the lead. We have Star Is Born, we have Green Book, and we have Roma right now, who are the 3.
Do you think it's going to be like 2015? Like, we don't know who wins until the end.
La La Land really did crush. I just went back and looked back at it.
Didn't
like it, just it ate everything.
What was 2015 again?
That it was The Revenant, 2015. It was Mad Max, it was Spotlight, it was The Big Short. The Big Short won PGA.
The drama winner was The Revenant, and the comedy winner was The Martian.
still funny.
I know, but I mean, about the race as a whole, like,
no, that was actually a really good race,
yeah, because people were between The Revenant and The Big Short, and then this
the year of Brie and Leo,
all that. That's a really good year. That was a good year for film.
I still think Michael Fassbender should have won.
Oh, 100%, 100%.
Ridley Scott should have won.
No,
with Odie,
get out of here.
Ridley Scott. Ridley Scott.
Yeah, he wasn't even nominated, but like he should have won.
Who? Ridley Scott?
Yeah.
Fucking
Lenny Abrahamson. I love this movie. Room is amazing.
Oh, Room is amazing.
Well, fucking Lenny Abrahamson took his spot.
Ouch. Wow. Abe is hot under the collar tonight, ladies and gentlemen.
So the Globes did not pick the best picture winner last year, and they did not pick it in 2015 or for the 2014 year.
They're not an end all be all. Just everyone is clear. This is not mean. Yeah. Bohemian Rhapsody's gonna win on Oscar night.
No, I don't think the Bohemian Rhapsody is going to win on Oscar night. But like, they haven't missed too many in the last decade.
No. If anything, this kind of solidifies Bohemian Rhapsody's getting nominated for Best Picture.
They missed in 2010.
All right, well,
2009. Anyways,
Ryan is looking at that statistic. No, that statistic. What was your favorite win of the night, guys, before we close out? Malcolm, what is your favorite win of the Golden Globes this past year? This past week?
I mean, for me, it would have been it is actually between Rami Malek winning for actors. I mean, it's one of those ones, like, as much as I like Bradley Cooper, I did have Rami Malek a little bit higher on my end. But, I mean, I did like seeing Spider-Man win for animated as well. It's refreshing to see something that's not Pixar.
Hmm. Abe, while you're playing your... Was that Pokemon Go? What are you playing?
Yeah, it's because of nothing for my coat. It's for a mission.
Abe, what did you like?
I really like Olivia Colman winning. And Shadow, Spider-Verse. Mm. Like, the top categories, I was... Well, Cuarón winning, for obvious reasons.
Yep.
But, like, just... Like, that, I wasn't surprised by that. I was just... he's gonna win it.
Yeah,
he got it up. That it's just I wasn't thrilled. Like I think the last award like soured my name. Like
yeah,
so the joy I was disappointed. I got drunk that night. I lost a hand. I lost a hand. It was a dark night.
I gotta say, lost a hand.
Yeah,
I see your hands? Are they okay? Did you sew it back on?
Yeah.
Okay.
We stick it together.
So, glad to know you found it. Ryan, what was your favorite win of the night?
So I had two that I am having an impossible time deciding between, so I'm going to say both.
Go ahead.
First is for Best Director, Alfonso Cuarón. He's one of the best directors just working mm-hmm. in general. And I think that, you know, when you saw him in that category with all those other guys, like, he's so head and shoulders ahead of all of them in terms of the craft of directing. I appreciate seeing excellence win. and I was happy to see him win. And then the other one, another guy who I think is defining excellence and who I was surprised to learn hasn't done a film without his director. He's only done films with one director. But I think is near or at the top of his craft was Justin Hurwitz for First Man.
Mm.
Shockingly, he has not scored a film that was not directed by Damien Chazelle, which I think is absurd, but he has made maybe the best score in the last 20 years, a couple years ago, and this score was also deeply excellent, and I was just ecstatic to see him win.
I am going to agree with that one. That's my pick, because I didn't think First Man had a shot. I thought it was dead on arrival. No, this made me very happy on the night. It shows the movie wasn't forgotten, and Justin Hurwitz is a fantastic composer. And I'm now looking forward to seeing what he can do in the future, because I know it's going to be something with Chazelle. but
Justin Hurwitz did write an episode of The Simpsons.
Wait, what?
he wrote music for, or he wrote an episode of The Simpsons?
Well, I'm thinking that he wrote an episode of Simpsons because he's listed as writing an episode called The Falcon and the Doman.
Okay. Fact check. We must know this. Where is
he wrote it. I'm in his IMDb.
You're
he
kidding.
Wrote it.
Wow.
The Falcon and the Omen was a 2011 episode of The Simpsons. I can tell you the IMDb score right now.
Fascinating.
It's a 7.2. It stars Dan Castellaneta, Julia Kavner, Nancy Cartwright. You want the whole cast of the episode?
No, nope, I mean, we're good.
That's just the cast of The Simpsons.
I'm about to say, yeah.
Yeah, wow. But yeah, I was just very shocked. I'm shocked that, like, because composers do a lot of work in general. Like, they're pretty well worked as a profession.
Mm,
there's only, like, six of them who are, like, particularly good.
Six. It's like, well, hey, we're getting a lot of young ones or new faces now coming up to the crowd now that some of the other ones are
yeah
either retiring or, because, you know, John just Williams.
Getting, just getting too old to not do like 20 films a year.
Yeah, so I'm glad that like the new, like, you know, Nicholas Britell and Justin Hurwitz, those people are coming up out of nowhere.
He's the best one right now.
He is one of the best. He is one of the best right now.
Jacob Water and Grand Budapest talk by themselves.
Okay, sure. And also, I love Shallow. I just love the song Shallow so much. Just seeing Lady Gaga and her entourage, if you will. I forgot them by name, but winning that was really, really fun, really great. And not the last time we're gonna see that win.
Yeah.
And I'm okay. And I am okay with that. It is still.
It's going to be interesting to see if it wins the best movie song at the Grammys, because the Grammys do love Kendrick Lamar so much. So
true. It did get nominated at the Grammys for best song.
Okay, but how many Grammy awards are there for best movie song? Because there are like a bajillion. There are like
for best movie song, but I think they've also got one for soundtrack and score. Okay. But most of the scores, the Grammy nominations are strange because quite a lot of the scores are for movies that came out in 2017 because of the time they released their nominations.
Yeah. Okay.
They released their nominations really early in November.
Shallow got nominated for Record of the Year and Song of the Year. That's impressive.
Yeah, wow, that is impressive. Jesus.
because although it's right below it, All the Stars. So those movies are basically
I mean, they're songs.
Yeah. I'm impressed.
Yeah, I mean, what I could see happen is I'm pretty sure they've got a category for Song for Motion Picture as well, there as well. So what I can see happen is when it comes to song and record, I wouldn't be surprised if All the Stars get one of them, but Shallow gets the other one.
It's possible.
It is impossible indeed. All right. Before we start heading out, guys, we are so close, so close to the Oscar nominations. So before that actually takes place, it will be announced on a Tuesday morning, bright and early. We'll be doing a live stream for that. We will see if these three guys are up for that, if they get up in time. If not, that's okay. But we're going to try to go live for all you guys so we can have a nice discussion. But before that, on that Monday, which is, I'm looking at the date right now, it is the 21st of January. On the 21st of January, on a Monday, we will be having a live episode of Gone with the Wind. So we'll be interacting with you guys. We'd love to hear from you all. And we'll answer your questions and having our final Oscar predictions. Because next week, guys, we're going to start formulating our Oscars, not officially, but we're going to start ruminating upon that because we are getting to the final stretch for Oscar nominations, at least. And then you have to wait a couple more weeks until we get to the award show itself. Almost a full month.
At some point.
Watch it be right on Chinese New Year's.
Which is February 5th. I looked it up.
February 5th. Watch it be February 5th, and then I'll just bow down to Abe for however he pulled that out.
Okay.
You are in a feisty mood, Abe. Jeez Louise. Any last thoughts you guys have concerning the Golden Globes this year? And what do you guys hope might they can change, get better? What do you guys hope for next year?
That a mediocre movie doesn't win. That's the only hope I have.
Wow. Okay. Brian, Malcolm?
That'd be nice. I want a return to drunkenness and insanity at the Globes. The last 2 years have been very sanitized. I want some craziness back at the Globes.
I do agree. Let the sanitization happen at the Oscars. I will take craziness at the Globes. That's what you're known for. And Malcolm, anything you went to tell the Globes?
Find hosts that have a good... good camaraderie with each other, like they don't seem like they're in separate worlds. And try it. I mean, release the brains a little bit so they can actually break out and get a little
crazy,
too controversial, but don't feel like they're not allowed to insult anyone.
Agreed. And for me, I just kind of hope that they, I kind of agree with Ryan. They go back to, you know, just more utter insanity, something incredibly fun, because don't take yourself too seriously at the Globes. It's the Golden Globes, for Pete's sake. Just have fun. And if you get to win, and if you win, get up there. And if you're drunk, try to just get your way through it. Okay. Because this is the Oscars are professionalism. And if you're greatest, Golden Globes, have fun. Have fun, ladies and gentlemen.
Also, congratulations to Jeff Bridges. I don't think that we talked
about that. Oh, you're right. Congrats, Jeff Bridges. And also, what are you guys' favorite Jeff Bridges performance that we've had so far? Like, I know one for me personally. Tron always have a good place in my heart. It's not his best, but it's one that's always had like a special place in my heart just because it's one of the first I've ever saw of him in period. But personally, I love his performance in True Grit because that's like the most... Jeff Bridges, like, doing this weird Jeff Bridges like I've ever seen, this pure, like, cowboy western. He fits so perfectly. I've been waiting him to do a western for so long like that, and it's wonderful. But that's just me. I think I know what... Ryan, what's yours?
Well, that's just, like, your opinion, man.
Yep, I saw that coming.
The Big Lebowski, my favorite comedy of all time.
Thank you.
So amazing.
Abe, I know what yours is.
I have so many quotes in my head.
They're gonna kill her, man.
But like, just to mention a different one, I think he's great in The Fisher King.
Okay.
That's a good pick. Good pick. And then Malcolm, any Jeff Bridges performance?
Well, I've kind of got two. I liked him in the first Iron Man as Obadiah Stane.
Yeah.
And the other one is as much as the movie wasn't as good as the first one, I actually did like him in The Golden Circle. Kingsman, The Golden Circle.
Okay.
I don't even remember doing that.
He played Champagne.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Champagne. Yeah, he's really good at... Also, shout out to his best performance this year in... Bad Times.
Oh, yes. My God, that was so good.
It wasn't it, though? Wasn't it, though?
That movie is so...
I haven't seen it yet.
It's so, so good.
On the subject of Iron Man, though, I think that Jeff Bridges, he has the best, like, two-line exchange with somebody in all of the Marvel Cinematic Universe in that movie.
Which is?
Where he's, like, freaking out under the arc reactor. He's like, Tony Stark built this in a cave with a box of scraps. And then the guy responds, I'm not Tony Stark. And it's such a great, like, hilarious exchange. But, like, it shows, like, heroism. It's like one of the best writing moments in the MCU, and I just adore that moment. And
they probably wrote it like that day because they wrote that script in the day.
Yeah, and like it's amazing. It's an amazing moment, and Jeff Bridges makes it all the better because Jeff Bridges is amazing.
He has like... He's not like a Daniel Day-Lewis where he like transforms into all his roles that he does, but he's someone who just like you just like you enjoy to watch. Like, he's someone who just oozes charisma on the screen.
Yeah, it's weird to think his Oscars for Crazy Heart.
Yeah, isn't it though?
Talking about.
Yeah, I mean, sure, I guess. I forgot about Crazy Heart. Apparently, he's also in Surf's Up. If that montage told me, which I completely forgot about that.
Yeah, he's one of the penguins.
I'm going to have to go watch that again, because actually, I'm not going to do that to myself.
I'm like, do you?
No, I don't. I just want to see something about Jeff Bridges now, but we'll do that later. Anyway, thank you guys so much for watching. Where can the people follow you, Ryan, on the social medias?
Find me on Letterboxd, rmckenna19, and find me on Twitter, rmckenna19. Actually, just find me wherever you want to find somebody at rmckenna19.
To find you in person, it'll be really strange.
If you're in Edmonton and you want to find me,
say hi.
Go for it.
Oh, that'd be a little
creepy, but sure.
Malcolm, where can they find you over on that Tuesday you're at?
You can find me on Tape View Productions, where I host my own show, Rankin. We're back to our normal format next week, and our topic is officially settled on the poll, and you voted in top 12 dogs in movies.
Dogs.
In honor of the Dog's Purpose sequel, which I don't think anyone really cares about, but it's still coming. So there's that. You can also catch me competing in trivia on Full Metal and Multiplex. You can also find me on Twitter, Letterboxd, and Stardust at Melkor.
And hey, where can they find you when you're not having this attack knowing Bohemian Rhapsody 1?
You can find me on the comments of the rank and poll when Spike doesn't win from the Rugrats, doesn't win that rank and poll.
Oh,
number one. This is the best movie dog. Have you watched the first Rugrats movie? He's a fucking hero of the movie.
Say solid movie.
Great movies. I haven't watched them like in 15 years, but they're still great. You come on with
15?
15.
Unless it's 50 years, I'm like, wow, Abe, you look great for your age.
Thank you, I know. I'm on Twitter at AbrahamF25. So hashtag Spike4, number one.
All right. Well, go back and watch Rugrats the movie, because apparently it's supposed to be really good. And you can find me on Twitter at Cena_man. I'm getting really a lot better at actually engaging in Twitter. So this podcast is helping me do that. So thank you, podcast, and thank you all for people who are watching, commenting, and subscribing to our channel at Take Three Productions. I'm loving doing this show, and it's only gonna get even better as we head closer to the pièce de résistance. Thank you all, guys, for tuning in. We will see you guys at the cinema. Have a good night.